first presentation is I am a little ahead. The first presentation is titled Active Targeting as Modulators of Nanomedicines and Pharmacokinetic Profile. It will be presented by Professor Seymour Schwartz, who is Director of Molecular Biology and Biochemistry, Research Center for Nanomedicine, University Hospital Waldi Hebron, and the Institute of Research in Barcelona.
So, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, like every year. The goal of this talk is just to show you some example, an example from work that has been done in my lab. It has been coordinated by Ivania Vascolo here and all these people. Just to give you an example of how an active targeting system might change the pharmacokinetic profiles of a nanoconjugate. So we all know that the addition of some polymers like polyethylene glycol, for instance, might change these characteristics. So it might make liposomes stealth, and they change the photon biodistribution and accumulation. But the question was whether an active targeting, which was much more simple, like a small peptide, for instance, might do that too. No? And this is an example that this happens. We have been working with lipophilic anti-cancer drugs and these kind of nanoparticles, which are based on polyurethane and polyurea. This has been done also with in collaboration with groups of the Barcelona Scientific Science Park and two companies, the Ecopol, who is the company in charge of performing this kind of nanoparticles, and PharmaMar, which is the owner of the lipophilic drug that we that you have here. This is pleitidepsin. It's called apidine. It's highly lipophilic. Highly lipophobic, actually. So it has a very poor biodistribution and viability. This makes it difficult in terms of using it in the clinical practice, although it's being tested at this moment for phase 3 clinical trials for myeloma. It has a very strong activity in different cancer cell lines, but in vivo, the biodisponibility and biodistribution is not optimal. It has a marine origin. This company, it's called PharmaMar, is a company that just work very much with compounds that have been extracted from the marine, from the sea. So the main idea was to test if we can improve actually the PK and the biodistribution by using the specific targeting systems. This is the kind of nanoparticles that we use. So there's an hydrophobic the use of polyurea and polyurethane, it allows to have this multi-wallet external part of the nanoparticle in which this is more hydrophilic. These two polymers have a peptide linker in between, which allow us to have an emulsification of non-phyphilic and hydrophobic polymers cross-linked. We have also some hydrophobicity here with different side chains, and these make these nanoparticles suitable in the sense that besides being multi-walled, is very highly responsive to redox conditions. So the inner core is very hydrophobic, which makes it very good for this drug, which is, as I was saying, very lipophilic. So the drug was being carried in the inner part of it, and we encapsulate also a drug fluorophore. In this case, it was the IL for monitoring the internalization and the biodistribution of the nanoparticle. And we use as an active target RGD. Actually, it was functionalized with this. This is, as you know, a peptide that reacts and is recognized by the alpha 5 beta 3 integrins, which are receptors that you will find in very high numbers in endothelial cells, for instance. We know for the other works that we have that the use of RGD peptides allow nanoconjugates to internalize much faster in endothelial cells, in the vasculature. And this was compared to the obviously non-targeted nanoparticles. These are some data on the characteristics of these polyurea particles. As you will see, there are some small changes in the CETA potential when you use the addition of RGD, but they're very small, mainly compared to what's the nanoparticle without the RGD. Of course, the addition of the pyridepsin also changes a little bit the CETA potential, but well, more or less the distribution in size of the diameter is quite regular. So at the end, we have these particles in a medium size from 90 to 110 nanometers, low polydispersity, close to neutral in surface charge, and very high encapsulation capacity. The most interesting thing was precisely to use the RGD because, as you know, this is a peptide that contains a positive and a negative residue, so it has a sweet organic characteristic, so it's working as a dipole. And one of the good things is that these charges changes very much in terms of, for instance, on the pH that is surrounding the molecule, and this is a good thing because on the tumor inner part the pH is different. So this we know that I'm not going to show you this, but we know that the use of this kind of peptides helps to change the conformation of these nano capsules, and then the release is much faster in the tumors. So what happened when we add this active targeting, for instance, and we check on the MTD? This is the maximum tolerated dose, so we're talking about toxicity here. No? So you see that there's a change immediate. This can be kind of expected. So when you use nano conjugates, one of the things that you would like to see is that you effectively can change the toxicity of the drug. This is what you see here. Pyridepsin has an MTD which is three times lower than the nanoparticle, so it means that we will be able to administer like three times more without having toxic effects in vivo. This is done in vivo, and one interesting thing is that we can also change the PK profile. So it's not just that we change the PK completely from the drug to the nanocapsules. Is that also there are some small changes, although you can see a little bit here. There's a change on the Cmax in the area under the curve. On those nanoparticles compared to the pyridepsin, but also on the one that has the RGD, there's some changes. The most interesting thing, though, of the addition of this RGD is not the change in the half-time, for instance, which is very small. I mean, there's not a big deal in that sense, but the change on biodistribution. And here you can see a very big difference depending on whether you have the RGD or you don't. No? So the accumulation in the liver, for instance, is much lower. Very different when you have the RGD added to the nanoparticles than when you don't. No, this is the uptake by the liver. So the uptake is much higher when the nanoparticle doesn't contain the RGD, no, than when the nanoparticle has the RGD. So we know now that the addition of these small peptides might modify very much how macrophages and the reticular endothelial system recognize the nanoparticles and take them. And the same thing happened for other tissues. So especially for those ones which are like spleen or liver that has the reticular endothelial system activated, but also the behavior in other ones like lung, for instance, or kidney are a little bit different. So in this case, the level in lung is a little bit higher because we have much more nanoparticle in the bloodstream than with the RGD than without. And we see also some a little bit more excretion by the kidney, a little bit more accumulation in kidney. So it is feasible just by adding a small peptide just to modify a little bit the behavior and the distribution that you will have in a nanoparticle. On the other hand, we think that these changes in biodistribution are linked to the peptide and most likely will be because of these heterogeneous characteristics. So the more neutral the charge you have, so the less recognition by the endothelial, by the reticular endothelial system. Okay. So thanks very much for your attention. If you have any question, I'll be glad to answer.
That's a very precise presentation. So it's open for questions. Maybe could you sort of elaborate a little bit more on, you mentioned that in certain organs, the concentration is less, and is that because the macrophages take up those nanoparticles, there are other factors?
Well, in the case of liver and spleen, we believe so. I mean, the main reason why nanoparticles have been sequestered on those tissues are because of macrophages just take them and they eat them. So obviously, if you have a system that might avoid this sequestration, like making the nanoparticles stealth, that's going to be decreased. And I think that's what's happening in this case too, like in other examples using polyethylene glycol, for instance. Of course, if you have an active targeting, what you would like to see is that you have your nanoparticle much more concentrated in those tissues in which the expression of the target is higher. Now, in this case, it will be higher in the endothelial cells of the microvasculature. That's why you have a little bit more accumulation on the lung, for instance, and also on the tumor in these cases, although I didn't show you that because the APR effect is also there. So I'm not saying that the active targeting will improve the APR in a significant way, because probably we're not normally seeing this. But it's true that even though you cannot improve the APR effect many times using active targetings, we see, for instance, in tumor cells, higher accumulation rates on cancer stem cells if the target is the right one. So, but refers to microphages, that's for sure. Yeah.
So it's another question.
I just wonder, when you show the data for the RGD peptides, did you have controls with scrambled amino acid sequence so we are sure that it is a real targeting effect and not just a changing of the surface charge?
I didn't show it, but we have data with the same RGD peptides showing that if you block, in fact, the expression by using other ligands, for instance, of the alpha-5 beta-3 integrins, then you see that there's a reduction in internalization using the RGD. So we're pretty convinced that this is what's happening in this case.
Another quick question about the role of size of nanoparticles, excretion by the kidneys, and is there a way to calculate the pharmacokinetic, that if you have the size, and when you predict how much of it would be...
Not to my knowledge, not in our experience, yeah.
How much you allow for that?
No, well, you know that if a nanoparticle is small enough, then will be secreted by the kidney because it just gets filtered. No, very difficult just to from scratch or just in an empiric way just to predict how much it will be excreted or what kind of percentage of the injected dose, for instance, will be secreted because at the end you have a combination of factors in vivo, no? Like how much will be sequestered by the reticular endothelial system, how much will go to the right target and will be internalized, and so therefore there's no predictive way, to my knowledge, or at least in our hands, to have an idea how much or which percentage of the injected dose will be secreted by the kidney, not in advance.
Another factor would be the proportion of certain sizes, because in the dose that you will give, not all the nanoparticles are going to be the same size.
They're not exactly the same, but the distribution was quite homogeneous in general. And this was done also in serum plasma, so...
thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much.
So the next